Then sings my soul. Glorified in this place, and even as we flow through the air to every part of the earth, be glorified in every life present, in every situation. Be glorified. Let your word come with clarity, let him come with power. In Jesus' name we pray. I want us to turn to Exodus in chapter 33 and from verse 12. Then Moses said to the Lord, "See, you said to me, bring up this people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. Yet you have said, I know you by name. And you have also found grace in my sight. Now therefore, I pray, if I have found grace in your sight, show me now your way, that I may know you and that I may find grace in your sight. And consider that this nation is your people." And he said, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." Glory be to God in the highest. Amen. Maybe I should just quickly remind you before I begin to make any comment here. Acts chapter 9 in verse 31. I read, "Then the churches throughout all Judea, Galilee, and Samaria had peace." Had peace. "And they were edified and walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit, they were multiplied." Glory be to God in the highest. I want just to bring out some similarities. The answer God gave Moses is that my presence will go with you and I'll give you rest. And the pattern here concerning the churches is that there was peace. And they were edified. And of course, they continue to multiply. Can I prophesy to somebody's life this morning in the name of Jesus? In spite of these losses and the seeming truncation, a new beginning for you in the name of Jesus. An unusual multiplication in the name of Jesus. Every barrier on your part is coming to naught in the name of Jesus. You know, it's interesting that when we talk of the Holy Ghost, it can be gentle. Praise the Lord. It can be gentle. Comes like a wind. Just whew. And sometimes in bodily form, like we saw in Jordan. But sometimes when the Holy Ghost is present, it's fire, you see. And we have examples. Hello. And Jesus was talking, saying, he will baptize you with what? The Holy Spirit. And with what? Uh-huh. So when we talk of the presence of God, there is always that aspect of him that empowers and opens up for you. But the flip side of that is that whatever will stop you, we see the wrath of God. It's the same Holy Spirit. The very same Holy Spirit. And so I want to prophesy, whatever constitutes a hindrance in your place of assignment, and please, my own definition of place of assignment is broad, I hope you know that. It begins with the fact that you are a husband, you are a wife, you are a father, you are a mother, and then of course, your calling, your ministry, your endeavors, everything you do to fulfill the purpose of God in your life, they all fall under your assignment as far as I'm concerned. So let it be said in the name of Jesus that we declare it today that whatever is standing in your path of progress, let it be accursed in the name of Jesus. I say, let the fire of the Holy Ghost consume in the name of Jesus. You know, see, God's attitude towards his people is this. Look at the situation with Joshua. He said, no man shall be able to stand before you. Literally meaning, no man shall be able to stand against you in opposition in the place of your assignment. It will be suicidal for them to stand. And that's why I prophesy your prosperity, your progress, and every hindrance is cursed, destroyed in the name of Jesus. That is the plan and the purpose and the pattern of God. But then it requires you knowing that God positioned you. For those who are ever thinking that I made a mistake, I married the wrong wife, how do you expect God to defend you? When all you think and say is that, I made a mistake, that means that you live the rest of your life making mistakes. God forbid in the name of Jesus. I shouldn't have married that man. But you're married. So what should we change? Begin to give God praises. Begin to thank him, because when you begin to praise God, even the hard ground will yield. Is somebody hearing me? I'm talking of God and his people. God is never purposeless. Man is funny. God is complete. Glory be to God in the highest. So as long as you have come to a place where you understand that you are walking in the purpose of God for your life, you will prosper. In the name of Jesus. Let me say again, somebody came in here half discouraged. And now you are beginning to see that God is charging you up. And let me say it again in the name of Jesus. 1 week will not go by, you will have a testimony. In the name of Jesus. I say you will come back with a testimony. In the name of Jesus. Glory be to God in the highest. So, following the pattern of the church had peace, Moses came asking God, and God, the way God answered, he said, my presence will go with you, and I will give you rest. I hope you understand that the rest here does not mean that you should be lazy. No. Rest in the place of assignment. Rest means that you'll be focused, you'll be one-minded, you will not be distracted. You'll not be thinking, looking at your back and looking at your front. No. God himself will surround you. And then you will be calm and focused. And so progress will be inevitable. And that's why we say, again, let me take the case of Joshua. He says, you will prosper in everything, and you will have what? Good success. Joshua 1:8. He said, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. You meditate therein day and night, observing to do all that is written therein. Then you will be making your way prosperous. And you have what? Good. Good success is possible. Good success comes when you are focused. And so everything that is pinching you and pulling you left and right, can I pray a dangerous prayer? May God cut them off in the name of Jesus. So that you'll be complete, you'll be able to focus on what God has called you to do. You can continue to supply your own bit to the entire body. Because you see, you are a gift to the body of Christ. You are a gift to your generation. But of what use if you cannot produce your fruit? If you cannot, that you will be fruitful. He says, you did not choose me, I chose you. And I chose you to bear fruit. So anything that will hinder your bearing of fruit in your place of assignment is not of God. No matter how good they may look. Let me quickly begin to round up this one. The context is clear. It's a story we're all familiar with. I'm just bringing this out in the light of the church and the nation. The church is not one person. The nation is not one person. So when we talk of the church, we talk of you and I. And of course, we talk of the church on earth, we talk of you and I and our likes in every nation of the world. And what God is making clear to us is this. We can complain all we want about the nations if we don't take our stand. And the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, they are mighty through God pulling down strongholds. But weapons are to be used. If you don't employ your weapons, how can they pull down? What we have perfected over the years is complain and complain and complain and judge. You know, we are the best coach still on the stand. That boy should have been playing that wing and that wing. He should have kicked the ball this way. That's all we do. We know how to talk and describe and analyze. And judge and even get ourselves very prideful. Whereas what we're called to do is decay. God forbid in the name of Jesus. Let me say it again. If you handle your assignment with levity for whatever reason you may have, whether you're intimidated or you're foolish, God will not ask from anybody, he will ask you. But don't you ever think that that assignment will be wasted. God will choose somebody else to do it. Adam can say all he wants about it. The woman you gave me, I hear you. Another man, the second, well, of course, the last Adam is coming. Keep on complaining. Nobody will take your place. In the name of Jesus. Say, nobody will take my place. In my place of assignment, I will finish well. I will perfect it through the grace of God, which he has released on the assignment and on my life, in Jesus' name. All right. So, back to this Exodus chapter 33. One version says, I didn't bring it. Say, you keep on telling me. You keep on asking me to go lead them there. But very unlike you. By the time you are telling someone to go, you are standing by. You kept saying it. Please take them, lead them, take them, lead them, take them, lead them. But I can't see anyone going with me. I think he was modest. What he was saying is that, but you are not, I can't see any preparation from you to come with me. But he didn't want to say that. He said, but you haven't shown me who will go with me. You kept on saying, go, 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 go. But you haven't shown me who will go with me. That's the problem of the church today, whether corporately or individually. We just keep going, not minding who has to go with us. True. It's going to get better and better in Jesus' name. If anybody had told me that there will come a time in Nigeria when Christians will be slaughtered like over the past few years. I know the funny thing. Those of us who are a little bit far from their area, I think it's number. When you talk to the Christians from the north, some of them will tell them, sometimes we have to rethink our Christianity. But thank God that he does not fear. But don't you ever forget that the state of the nation is just a reflection of the church. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray. We have it in everyday life. Was it not Queen Mary at the time? I think of, was it Scotland? I can't remember. Who said, I fear the prayers of John Knox more than the armies of England and Wales all put together. That was to show you the kind of effect that's expected. That was proving the effectiveness of the prayer of one man, the prayers of one man. What when the church is praying and we're in agreement? It's up to the church. But it's pretty easy to begin to assume that everybody's responsibility is nobody's responsibility. No. In this case, it's your personal responsibility. It's the church. I hear we are many. Oh, I hear you. If everybody says we are many, we will pray. But what you fail to realize is that God marks everybody's contribution. Even in Ephesians, he said everybody has something to contribute to the body. But how can the church pray if they don't agree? The much that we see today was because the early church understood what we're saying and they walked that path. But somewhere along the line, we have issues. I want you to understand that we have a responsibility as a church. And you have a responsibility. The least you can do is never to be found in any place that will divide the body. The least you can do for yourself, never to be found in any place that will cause division and tear the body apart. No. You say, why are you saying that, Pastor? They had built the golden calf. They had worshipped the golden calf. when Moses was in God's presence, when Moses came, he broke the tablets. Let me quickly remind you, verse 17 of 32. And when Joshua heard the noise of the people as they shouted, he said to Moses, "There's a noise of war in the camp." But he said, Moses said, "It is not the noise of the shout of victory, nor the noise of the cry of defeat, so it cannot be war." So experience counts. It's not every shout that is a good one. So it was, as soon as he came near the camp and he saw the calf and the dancing, so Moses' anger became hot and he cast the tablets out of his hands and broke them at the foot of the mountain. Then he took the calf which they had made, burned it in the fire, and ground it. So there was a lot of trouble there. Look at verse 30. Now it came to pass on the next day that Moses said to the people, "You have committed a great sin. So now I will go up to the Lord. Perhaps I can make atonement for your sin." Then Moses returned to the Lord and said, "Oh, these people have committed a great sin and have made themselves a god of gold. Yet now, if you will forgive their sins, but if not, I pray thee, blot me out of your book which you have written." I'm talking of your assignment. People think their assignment, most of us now think their assignment is make me big, make me great, make me popular, make me this. Fine, those are fringe benefits, but that's not it all. Let the church hear, that's not it. It's not it. We've redefined it. And we wonder why the things that we should give command to move are taken as slaves. And the Lord said to Moses, "Whoever has sinned against me, I will blot him out." In other words, what do you mean? I'm not blotting you out. I will deal with the person who has sinned against me. Can you imagine Moses and God? What we have with God is more than that. What we have with God today is much better than that. But the problem is, do we realize it? Why I went there is that to see Moses going into intercede. Because he understood that this is my purpose in life. So it was with this background that in 33, then the Lord said to Moses, "Depart and go up from here." It's been a couple of years thereabout that look, there was talk. "You and the people whom you have brought out of the land of Egypt to the land which I swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying to your descendants, I will give it. And I will send my angel before you, and I will drive the Canaanites and the Amorites and the Hittites." He said, look. God was painting a very beautiful picture again. "I will do," see, "take them to the land flowing with milk and honey." The land is flowing with milk and honey. It's a land that I've promised by covenant to give, and I will give that land and see what I'll do for you. I'll go before you. I will clear the road for you. I hear you. Beautiful description, beautiful scenario. But see, it wasn't the devil talking to Moses. Okay. It was God. Yeah. Beautiful promises. A land flowing with milk and honey. And it's in accordance with the covenant which I've entered into with their forefathers. Number two. Land flowing with milk and honey. It's what I've promised to do. I will keep my covenant. Number three. I will go before you, clear. He didn't say I will go for you. He just said, which means I will go for you. I will go for you and I will clear the Hittites. I will clear the Jebusites. I will clear the Amalekites. I will clear the road for you. Moses, take them. God speaking. But Moses noticed that God didn't say something. He didn't say, I will come with you. That was the only thing out of the equation. You talk of the church and the Holy Spirit. And that was what led to what we read. You keep saying to me, bring up these people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. Again, I said it was a piece of humility to say whom you send. It was short of saying, he didn't say you will come with me. He didn't say, who will you send with me? Yet you said to me, I know you by your name. And that today, Moses, I love you. You have grace with me. I hear you, sir. But you didn't say you come with me. I know you love me. I know you know me. But you didn't say you come with me. Now, therefore, I pray. Is it a place of prayer? If indeed I have grace with you, of course I believe you, but I'm still questioning the fact that you don't want to come with me. Then show me your way. You understand what I say? I thought I understand you. That when you say I have grace with you, it means that you are with me, you are walking with me. But now you are saying I have grace with you. And you are saying, you are not telling me you are going to come. You need to teach me for that. I have a problem here. I have a problem. Show me your way. I thought I knew it. Show me your way. I thought I knew it. But anything about my understanding that does not carry your presence is questionable. Any knowledge I have that does not include your presence, I have a problem. Let the church understand that. Why? So that I may know you. I used to think I do, but I think I have more to learn. And consider that this nation is your people. By the way, you said my people. No, they are your people. He didn't let that land. You see, it was verse 1, he said, the people which you have brought, verse 2. Moses replied, said, no, and by the way, they are your people, not my people. Then he said, God now answered. So God understood his argument. My presence. So that's all the problem. My presence. My presence. My presence. Why don't you let us thank God for his presence? Why don't you just let us give him praise for his presence? My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest. And that's why, even in the midst of tribulation, there is a rest. There is a progress. There is an ever-increasing glory. He says, even in captivity, you will multiply. Shall we rise? The comfort of the Holy Spirit. And the church kept on multiplying. In Jeremiah 29:7, he said, as you seek the peace of that land, you will continue to increase. But look at it this way. Thank God for the increase that is coming my way. But look at what God is using. You are the key to the peace of the land. You are the key to the rest that will pervade the nation. And therein is your prosperity and your increase. It says, there is none like you. No. My heart. like you do. I can search through all eternity and find there is none like you. One more time. There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. I can search through all eternity long and find there is none. I want us to do what Moses did. He prayed. First, he interceded for the people, prayer. And when God began to say move, and he just didn't understand how one could move without the Holy Spirit, without God. Because I hope you know that God the Father will not jump down in the physical. He will walk with you through the Spirit. He just didn't understand how that could work. And you know what really beat me? Which I keep on asking God for grace for every day. If it was this important, and they were this dedicated to it in the Old Testament, God help me. It's not like I don't know about the Holy Ghost. It's not that I don't respect Him. It's not like I don't involve Him. But not often. Sometimes you just take 2, 3, 4 steps as usual. And they come as usual. Until you now feel, you say, oh. Then I say, God help me. It's when you have problems. And that's why all our prayers are always prayers of, in the name of Jesus, help me. In the name of Jesus, help me. We are always catching up. When we can walk in the comfort of the Holy Spirit. I'm not saying that there won't be problems. No. Even Jesus said there will be tribulations. But Jesus says, you don't set out without the Holy Spirit. That's what He does. It doesn't cancel the opposition, but it makes the opposition powerless against you when you have to move. No one dare join them. Now they will come and sit down and begin to attack you in your place of assignment. No one dare. And yet the people esteemed them highly. Hey, where is the esteem of the church? Even the rats are attacking and abusing the church. When we have it, don't even know who we are and what we have. Nigeria has a great future. In the name of Jesus. You say, why? Nigeria has us. He has you and He has me. He has Fountain, He has Catholic, He has Redeemed, He has Cherubim and Seraphim, He has us. Because in every church, there are true people. In every nation, God has a people, no matter how wicked they may look. If only my people will humble, and pray. Let's give Him praise. Let's give Him honor. Father, we worship You. Take all the glory. In Jesus' name.